We apologize for the delay. It was just a small technical issue that we had to solve. Would you all bow your heads with me for a moment? Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord God, for your loving, tender spirit, the spirit of the Lord that we can feel in this place. And so today, Lord Jesus, as we just let our hearts be open to receive, Lord God, from you, I just pray that each person here will leave today with a sense of your great love for them and Ed's love for them as well. Lord, each person here has had a special relationship with him. And we thank you, Lord God, for the privilege and the honor of being here today to say our final goodbyes to a man who was loved so much and cared for so deeply. In Jesus' name we pray, all said, amen. Edward Genoviak. Edward Genoviak was 60 years old when he went to heaven on Sunday, November the 8th, 2020. He was born on July 19th, 1960, to Donald Lillian Genoviak in Muskegon. Ed worked as a specialist for GE Aviations, and prior to that, he worked at Eagle Ottawa Leather for 27 years. He served his country in the U.S. Army National Guard for 13 years. His passion was family, bowling, golf. I like how you guys put that in order there. Family, bowling, and golf. Ed was a member of Chase Hammond. Ed has a record hole-in-one at Hickory Knoll Golf Course. And that was in 1999. On the fifth hole, he hit a 131-yard shot. You can all go, wow. On June 26, 2004, he married his love of his life, Lily. Ed leaves behind his loving wife, Lily, of 20 years, seven children, Jason, Jessica, Michelle. Delia. I should have asked you before. And then the next one was?
Rochelle,
okay. Crystal, Pam, 19 grandchildren, three great-grandchildren, Donald Genoviak, Renee, Jackie, and along with nieces and nephews, and his best friends, Pat, Vinny, and John. He proceeds in death, his parents, his son-in-law, and Jeffrey, his friend. We are now going to have a song that you guys picked out for them.
Changes what you see.
As I was talking with the family and trying to get to know Ed, who I think must have been a fantastic fella because of all the things that they had shared with me about him. And as they were sharing the things, I thought about what would be Ed's perfect day. And I wrote down what I thought would be his perfect day. I think it would start out with meeting his friends, either for bowling or for a round of golf, and then moving on to lunchtime, where he could go and have a pizza, which was one of his favorite foods. He could have a pizza with them, and then coming back home after all of those activities to grill out and to have some steaks and what they called glumpies. You guys ever heard of a glumpy, which was his favorite food? They call it a pig in a blanket. And then from there, I could imagine him sitting down to watch some NASCAR racing or some sporting event and to finalize the day with a drive around the lake in his 1979 Lincoln with the woman that he loves. Does that sound like a good day for him? I think that would be his best day on planet Earth. But Lily's coming to share a few things about her husband, and if she would come now.
This is really hard, but I want everyone to know that he loved every one of us deeply. He kept his emotions hidden many times, but deep down we cried together many times. I love you from the first time I looked at you. Your eyes smiled. And when you smiled, when you sm your eyes smiled when you smiled. He always had that contagious smile. Everyone remembers that one. What they don't realize when he smiled, it was a real smile. Because your eyes will smile, you know, like this, instead of like a fake one. And I always told him that. He just laughed. He thought it was goofy. But it didn't take me any time to know that I was smitten for you. You loved your sports, from NFL to basketball to baseball, golf, you name it, Ed watched it. And then what I didn't like him watching was a little bit of soccer. I never got into that. I don't know, I thought the net was way too big for anything. I thought you go off with this little tiny ball and you put it in this little hole and then you play soccer with a ball, and then you have this huge net. Like, not getting that one. So, I often told you that you missed your calling. You knew the facts and trivia when, even though many of it was when you were younger, and he did. He knew records and people from back in the, you know, way back, even before me, and he knew facts and all of that. When he watched sports, they did the trivia on whether it was baseball, football, and he would get them right, and we'd laugh. And it's like, well, I wouldn't watch all of them with him because he goes from one thing to another. But he did know many facts, and I told him, I said, you missed your calling. You should have been a commentator, and I believe he would have made a great one. I often told you that you missed your calling, even though many of it was when you were younger, that you should have been a sports commentator. Sorry, I lost my place here. You would even argue with the referee on TV, not to mention all the yelling, as if they could hear you. And I usually kept myself busy in my office because he would get so mad, and so he would yell at that TV, and they called that wrong. That ain't what happened, and blah blah blah. I mean, it was irregular, and any time that something was important that he was watching. Sometimes I'd sit there, and if I sat there with him, then He was a little less, but as soon as I walked out of that room, man, he let it go. He loved Christmas movies. And he did, and your favorite one was A Christmas Card. It was about a veteran, and if y'all have a chance to watch it and you haven't watched it, it's a very good movie, and I believe it'll be a classic. Ed got that as a Christmas gift as well, and we often have watched it. Christmas movies started right when he first got in the hospital. And many times when I called, you were watching the same one I was watching.
Wow.
And there were several channels with different Christmas ones on now. It's just one thing that we just love doing. We watched a lot of it daily. You love the holidays, but this year will be different. I will miss you, my dear. But God's strength will bring us through. But you get to see your first Christmas in heaven. I can't imagine how big and beautiful that'll be. Now, 20 years later, I was blessed for God giving me these years to get to know you with all my heart. Make no mistake, love is unbreakable. It is a real life change. But we know love is the answer to all things. Until I see you again, keep smiling, babe. I know you are watching over us and smiling. And smiling at the same time. No, love you always. Now I want to be his voice because of the COVID. It's important to mask up. It's very important to... Man, and I prayed about this while Ed was in the, of course I prayed all the time, but this, he brought to me this one thing. And for those who wear your mask when you walk, you wait until you go into the store and you put it on. I asked the Lord and prayed. I said, Lord, why are all these people getting it even though we wear our mask in the store? And this is what came. He says, you need to mask as soon as you, before you open the car door, you put that mask on before and walk in to the store or wherever you're going. Because like Ed and I, we would always park way out in the parking lot because everybody wanted to get on top of you. It just seems like you. It's like, wow, why'd you squeeze that in there, you know? So it just reminded me that, so when you, that, when you look at the stretch of cars that are all down where you're walking, you probably see, what, 10, 20, maybe 30 if you're at a busy place. Well, all that time, how many people walked without their mask? Sorry. They're masked just like we did, the mask, and put it on when we got in the store. God reminded me that the COVID sticks in the air. It sticks for a good 10 minutes or more. So if 3 of the 10, 20 people that walked in before you and they were only minutes ahead of you, you're going to walk into it. I believe that's one of the reasons why people are getting the COVID more other than other. One of the reasons that it's happening, and it makes sense. So I'm reaching out, and I'm being his voice, and we don't want another one of our loved ones to pass from this horrible disease. This disease was not brought by God. This was brought by Satan. He's out to destroy, to kill, steal, and destroy. So please mask up and put that mask on when you open that door. You don't have to drive around with it on, but... And another thing... That next year, later on, his nephews and friends will get together and do a scramble in his honor, which I know he'd be proud. And then we'll have a gathering when it's all finished to come back to the house and celebrate his life. And I'll, and I have lots of plans for it because it means so much to me, and I know he'd be very proud. I love all you guys, and I thank you all for being part of God's of Ed's story, and it's not finished.
Yeah.
It's just beginning.
Yes. Thank you, Lily. Melissa's coming now, and she has her sister that wants to share.
Shelley.
What's that?
My sister Shelley.
Her sister Shelley is going to share something via. Yeah,
you call me Melissa.
What did I say? Okay. A lot of names today.
Yeah. I always get called Melissa. Shelley couldn't be here today. And she has something that she would really like to share, so she's going to be on speakerphone. So as soon as she calls, here she is. All right, Shelley, we have you here, and I have you on speakerphone.
Okay, hello, everyone.
Can you all hear? Okay.
I would like to start by saying, how you doing? As many of you know, this would be one of the first things out of Ed's mouth when you've seen him.
It's okay, Shelly.
His laughter filled the room, and it was always contagious. My mother was the love of his life, and of course, he loved to golf. He was a straight shooter, just like his golf game, willing to help others and always listened. I looked at Ed as a father figure. Even though not my biological father, he grew to fit that void. Together, he grew to love us girls and would be there for us if anything needed. 2 days before Ed passed, I had the pleasure of speaking with him over the phone. We had a heart-to-heart, and his words were, "You girls are so special to me." I will never forget that, as he is special to us. He will forever be missed and never forgotten. May your white light shine down on us as we continue our journeys on Earth. Much love, guys.
Thanks for sharing, Shelley. Love you.
Bye.
I just wanted to add that Ed meant a lot to us, too. He was always very accepting of us, no matter what he felt, you know, in his opinions. He was very accepting of us. Because we're very individual girls, we sure are. We all have our issues and this and that, but he never hesitated to help, ever. He was always there for us. And I came over once when Mom was in, just getting out of the shower, and I don't remember which one of the other girls had called while she was in there as well, and he hollered at her when he heard the water shut off, and he's like, "Number one's here, and you gotta call number three when you get out." So he always had us numbered. So I didn't know that until then, and that was evidently he had been doing that for quite some time. But he just always had a way to make us laugh, and he will be sorely missed.
Thank you, Michelle.
It's okay.
Amen. When I was thinking about the message that I wanted to share, I was thinking about how oftentimes we feel in our hearts, "Why, God?" Because who thought 3 weeks ago that we'd be sitting here in this room together?
Yeah.
Who thought? We had no idea. So oftentimes we ask ourselves, "God, why? God, why?" And so the message that I want to bring is the story called Calming the Storm. And each of us are in a great storm today. We are feeling the pain and the loss of someone that we love dearly. And in Scripture, if you will like to look it up at home, it's found in Mark chapter 35 through 38, is this story of the storm. And it says this: that day when evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go to the other side of the lake." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also others in the boat with him. A furious squall or storm came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Isn't that the way that we feel today? Overwhelmed, being swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion, and the disciples woke him up and they said, "Teacher, don't you care if we drowned?" And that's the point that I'm going to make reference to in just a moment. Don't you care? God, don't you care? This lake that the disciples were crossing was the Lake of Galilee, or the Sea of Galilee. And it is over 600 feet below sea level. It is one of the most beautiful places that you could ever imagine. At one moment, the sea can be completely calm and just amazingly beautiful, but in the very next moment, it can be a raging sea, a violent raging sea. And so sometimes when we are faced with a storm, it can be for many different reasons. It can be a financial storm that we're going through. It can be the news that we get from the doctor that was unexpected, that kind of a storm. It could be someone that you love, or it could be your marriage could be struggling, or it could be depression. It could be news that you get from your kids. It could be all kinds of storms that come up in your life. But the storm that we face today is one of the most challenging storms, and that is to lose someone that you love so deeply. And so I have a thought behind why we go through storms. And the first thing that I want to share with us, the reason that we go through storms, is by his appointment. That God knew before Ed was born the hours and the days that he would be on this earth. He knew the situation that he would be going through at the end and the moments of his life that were coming to the end. The scripture said this: that day when evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's go to the other side of the lake." Jesus knew that there was going to be a storm. Jesus is the Son of God. He knows all things, and he knew what they were going to come in contact with, what they were going to be faced with. So we can conclude in this storm, even though it was a raging tyrant, that Jesus knew that he was going to have to go through that with them. And so you might say to yourself, you know, Lord, why? Why would you allow this to happen? Well, let me say this, that there are different reasons that we go through storms. Some of the reasons that we go through a storm is because we make bad decisions. We decide to drive too fast in a car, and we get pulled over by the police, and we get a ticket. That's a bad decision we made. We're going through a storm. We have to pay that ticket. We may lose our license. It's a difficult thing, but it was from a bad decision. Other storms come because, like Lily said, we have a spiritual enemy. We call him Satan. Some call him the devil, Lucifer. And the Bible says, like she said, that he comes to seek and to destroy. And that's what he is trying to do in many, many lives, even today. But then there is a third thing that we often face in this world and the storms that come because we live in a fallen, broken world. A world that is marred in sin. Jesus said, in this world, you will have troubles. But he also said these words, take heart, for I have overcome the world. He is going to stand with us. In your storm, God knew that you would be going through it, but he also says that he is going to stand with you in that storm. Then it goes on to say, leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There was also others in the boat. When a furious squall came up and waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. That's the thing about storms. They come out of nowhere. It seems like that you're never going to be free from them. It seems like these waves come crashing over the boat. They hit you in the face with that cold, chilling water. And it takes your breath away, just like this situation. Nobody expected 3 weeks ago to be swamped with the information that we were going to lose Ed. No one could have conceived that idea. It was just unbelievable to us. But when we go through this, we have a promise when we go through a storm that it will be with his presence. Jesus said he would never leave us. He would never forsake us. But when the disciples were going through it, when they were rowing and when they were trying to get across the sea, guess where Jesus was? He was asleep on a cushion in the boat. And so here we have all of these disciples fearing for their lives. They were so afraid, and Jesus was asleep. Jesus was unseen, but yet he was there. He was there with them. And right now, as we are going through this storm, it may seem like, God, where are you? I need you. SOS, God, we're in trouble. We need your help. And God, don't you care? God, if you are real, God, if you are able, God, if you are able and you don't, does that mean that you are a good God? Are you a God that I just made up? Are you a God that I'm using for a crutch in my life? God, if you could, why don't you? Well, we have to remember that we don't know what God knows. We can't see what God sees. And we just have to put our trust in our faith in that he is going to walk through this with us. We're going to be in his presence. And then the third thing, the reason that we go through storms is for a purpose, for his purpose. And I want to tell you today that no one's life goes without purpose. I was once doing a funeral for a friend who lost his son, his 10-year-old son. The one thing they wanted to know was, what was the purpose? What was the purpose for that? God has a purpose for everything. The disciples disciples woke him up and they said, teacher, don't you care if we drowned? Of course he does. He cares deeply about everything we go through, every situation that we are in. You see, the disciples, they were going through this terrible storm. They were afraid for their lives. And you know what? The Lord was helping them to see that their greatest fear could not take them away from him, that he would stand with them during that terrible time that they were going through, that greatest fear that they had. And you know, they overcame that fear. They overcame that fear in such a way that they were willing later to give up their lives for the Lord, to give up their lives for Jesus. And 10 of them did just that. They gave up their lives for the Lord. The Bible says this in James, "Consider it pure joy, brethren, whenever you face trials of any kind, because you know that the testing of your faith will develop perseverance. Perseverance finishes its work so that you will mature and complete, be mature and complete, lacking in nothing." You know, you say to me today, what was the purpose in all this? I don't know all of the purpose, but like Lily said, it will be revealed. But I will tell you this, that 2 days ago I received a phone call from a friend who found out that he had COVID. He was having a terrible time because he has asthma as well, breathing. And I told them that I know somebody that we are doing a funeral for tomorrow. You need to go into the hospital today. Don't wait. Don't wait. You know what? He went into the hospital, found out what he had. He got the medication that he needed. It very well may be that Ed's loss of life may be the life of my friend. There's a purpose. There's a purpose for everything. And oftentimes when we are when we go through a storm, we want God to do a removing job, but he wants to do an improving job. We want God to take away the pain, and God wants to help us in the pain. Mark 4:39-40 says this, "He got up, he rebuked the wind and the waves. He said, 'Quiet, be still.' Then the wind died down and was completely calm. And he said to his disciples, 'Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?'" Would you bow your heads? There are those of you that God is speaking to this morning about the storm in your life. You're going through what seems to be some very difficult things. Maybe you are asking God for healing. Maybe you're going through a marriage struggle or financial issue. And God is telling you today that he's going to answer your prayer. And he is going to say to your storm, "Quiet, be still." But then others of you this morning are going through a storm like we are today. And it's going to continue to rage on in our hearts. And God is going to say, "Be still." And both will be miracles. But maybe those of you that have peace, when all hell is breaking loose in your life, maybe that's the most important miracle of all. Be still and know that he is God. Father in heaven, we thank you today that you are standing with us during this time, that you are bringing peace to our hearts when our hearts are broken, that you are going to be our strength and you are going to be our help and you are going to be our guide. We love you today, Jesus, and we thank you for what you are doing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We now have another song. God who stays. So, Ed, maybe I'll tell this in church tomorrow. I was asked to do this. There was a pastor who woke up one morning and saw that it was a beautiful sunny day. And it was a Sunday. He was supposed to go to church, but he decided to go golfing instead. So he called one of the guys at church and he said, "Hey, listen, you're going to have to preach today because I'm feeling kind of sick." And he went 42 miles outside of his parish or his district so that he wouldn't be seen. He got out there and the angel says to the Lord, "Lord, are you going to let him get away with it?" And the Lord says, "Don't worry about a thing." He gets up to the tee, he puts the tee in, he puts the ball on, he takes the swing, and he had the best drive of his life. And after one bounce, plunk, plunk, it was a hole in one. The angel said to the Lord, "Lord, why did you let him get a hole in one?" And the Lord said, "Who's he gonna tell?" I think I would like that one. You have your pennies? I want to tell you a story. This is a new tradition that I want to start and have just started recently. This is only the second time that I've done this. But there was a man, a very wealthy man, who was walking down the sidewalk when he saw a penny on the ground. He picked up that penny and he looked at it. And it said these words, "In God we trust." It made him think for a moment, "God, you've brought me so far. I had nothing. And now, Lord, I've got so much." And so he took that penny and he rubbed it and cleaned it and put it in his pocket. He told the Lord, "Lord, every time I find a penny, I'm going to pick it up. I'm going to put it in my pocket, and I'm going to remember what you've done for me." Well, in 1986, the very penny that I gave you, Lily, in 1986, in Philadelphia, there was a run of pennies that started. But halfway through the run, somebody noticed that there was a mistake. The words, "In God we trust," were blurry. And so he yelled, "Stop, stop, stop. Everybody stop the machines. We gotta reset them. Something's wrong." So they stopped all the machines and they restarted. The only thing was, is that some of the pennies got sent out. Well, when the collectors found out that there was a penny out there that was, messed up, it became very valuable. Anytime you find a 1986 penny with the words "In God we trust" that are blurry, that penny is worth $250. You know, you could have been passing that penny around many times. Who knows the thousands of dollars that you could be passing around that you never know that you had in your pocket? All these years, maybe in the drawer of your home or in the couch or underneath the couch, there is a penny worth $250. So many times we throw pennies away. We don't even think about them. As a matter of fact, when I clean up my car, I don't even clean. I just take the change in the middle of the car and I suck it up in the vacuum. It's just a bunch of pennies. I don't even look at them. They're worthless. But how many times have we overlooked or seen a penny on the ground that could have been worth something and we passed it by? We took it for granted. So today I gave each of you a penny. In just a moment, as you leave to pay your final respects, I'd like you to take that penny and place it on the table next to the urn. Because I want us to remember that we should never take for granted even the simple things in life. The phone calls, the passerby a wave. We should never take any time like that for granted, because who knew 3 weeks ago that we'd be sitting here together. I also think that when you find a penny, you should pick it up. And you should say to yourself, God, I trust you that everything is going to be okay, that I am not going to take the life that I have for granted, the people that I love that you put into my life for granted, and I am going to trust in you. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I want to encourage you to do that. The Bible says, they that believe on me shall be saved. I just want to encourage you today, if you don't know him, begin to make a relationship with him. Find a good church to go to. Find a place that you can learn more about him, because he will change your life. Amen. We're going to have a video of the life of Ed. And then after that video, would you come and pay your respects by placing the penny on the table?